number one issue facing modern marketers in 2020 is going to be content and the idea of a content bottleneck, meaning that you just can't generate enough content to support the personalization requirement. So going back to Peppers and Rogers, getting right message to the right person at the right time presupposes you can build scalable content and have it be individuated such that you have, you know, unique content going for each person during their buyer journey. It's expensive to do. And so I think what you found is a bunch of people have gone and, you know, they hired or, you know, outsourced content farms and just produce stuff because I just want to have differentiated. But if you don't...
And that's a wrap. The weekly wrap. Ending Friday, June 12th, 2020. This week has us wondering if we're waiting too long or not long enough to speak. We'll look at some new research on how gating content is actually creating new business models. And how content can perpetuate racism and inequity. We can all do better, right now. So let's wrap it up, shall we? Our theme this week is the power of the pause. As the writer Margaret Wheatley once said, our pause is to look carefully at a situation, to see more of its character, and to think about why it's happening, to notice how it's affecting us and others. That's the power of the pause, and this is the weekly wrap. Hello, everybody, and welcome to episode number 73 of the Weekly Wrap, our weekly play on words at play in the world this week. We took a beat last week, a pause. As I wrote in my Friday letter to all of you, nothing I say today will teach me. And so on that day, we looked up, I looked up, we listened. And so this week, we're back to talk about how we as marketers might take a moment, a second, a pause, to speak or not speak, to work our way through the silences, the unresolved, to better use the power of the pause. As always, I'm your host, Robert Rose, Chief Strategy Advisor for the Content Marketing Institute. And with no further ado this week, it's time to get the show underway.
Silences. Why do we feel it's necessary to yak about bullshit in order to be comfortable?
I don't know. That's a good question.
That's when you know you found somebody really special. And you can just shut the fuck up for a minute and comfortably share silence.
Well, I don't think we're quite there yet, but don't feel bad. We just met each other.
How long should you wait before you speak? One of the greatest skills that we humans have is the art of conversation. We know instinctually how to converse with just about anybody on the planet. Now that might be surprising to you. I'm not talking about, of course, the art of what it is we say. No, people's conversation skills and levels of keeping each other engaged, yeah, they definitely vary. No, what I'm talking about is the ability to optimize the gaps. The length of the silences between the end of my words and the beginning of yours. researchers have actually found that this innate skill is not dependent on culture or language. Now, there are differences in the cadences of languages, of course, but humans on average wait 200 milliseconds to actually wait between speeches. Interestingly, it actually takes more than 600 milliseconds for us to even formulate the simplest of responses. So the interesting things, our brain are already predicting the content and the timing of our answer while someone else is speaking. This phenomenon is so ingrained in people that we have inherent expectations and perceptions about the misplaced gaps, the silences. When you take a little too long to respond to your significant other, you might get, "Are you paying attention?" Or if you answer too quickly to that question of, "Do you want to go to my parents' house for dinner?" You say, "Of course I want to go to your parents' house for dinner on Sunday night. I can't think of anything that would be more enjoyable." Yeah, they might be questioning just a bit of your honesty there. There are rich, rich communications happening in the silences, the in-between of speaking. And we are listening. But when it comes to digital communication, we don't have this level of skill. There are no standards. There are no instincts that we can lean on. How quickly we should respond to a text, a social media message, a comment on a post. But of course, that doesn't mean we don't put meaning on those gaps, those silences. Studies have shown that 53% of consumers expect a customer service response on Twitter in less than an hour. 33% expect it in less than 30 minutes. And there are, of course, other expectations across text messaging, social media, email, all kinds of digital communications. And the truth is, we just don't know. We don't know how to behave. We're not sure. And this uncertainty is a big challenge. It's powerful. It's the power of the pause. And now, well, now it's time for a pause, just a moment, a time for our sponsor, the wonderful folks at Sitecore. For businesses managing content and all kinds of digital experiences today, well, it's become a business critical function. If you're thinking about the right answer to solve the challenges of marketing and content, Sitecore just might have good answers for you. In this uncertain time of change, organizations all over the world are being forced to reevaluate their business plans and marketing strategies. The luxury of being able to actually do something different and take a leisurely approach to digital transformation, it's no longer an option. Today, right now, is about making human connections with our customers. In this suddenly digital-heavy world, human, authentic connections, they're a top priority. And that means putting your digital transformation on the fast track. Recognized by analysts as a leader in digital experience platforms, Sitecore can help you create memorable customer experiences that build brand trust and loyalty. Learn more, won't you? I want you to go to this URL, cmi.media/sitecoredxp. That URL that you can see right on the screen here, cmi.media/sitecoredxp. I want to thank the good folks at Sitecore for their wonderful, wonderful sponsorship of our show. And now, well, now it's time to get to the news. So this week's news item is very interesting. It comes from a release of a report from FIP. And of course, FIP is the wonderful organization that looks at publishing and media and all of the issues around that. Now, I'll warn you in advance that this requires registration to put in your email address and stuff like that. But I think it's actually worth it. The news item that we'll link to in the show notes, of course, actually covers this piece pretty well, but the downloaded report is actually a really good report. The headline from What's New in Publishing is giving customers many reasons to come back, and this is insight from FIP's report on paywall strategies. And the reason I bring it up is because I think it's got so many wonderful correlations for where I see marketing and our efforts these days with paywalls. Now, we don't ask for money typically. Typically, what we just want is an exchange of data. And by the way, I totally get how this report requiring an exchange of data about being an exchange of data. I totally get it, by the way. Anyway, one of the other things that it does, I think, is also highlight some of the recent business model shifts that we've seen in the media business and how they're so important for us as marketers to look at. Anyway, the article opens up by saying the magazine industry has historically seen around 70% of their revenue come through print revenue and print advertising. And that's according to Phipps' updated edition of Paywalls, the subscription report. This is the report we're talking about here. The article continues on to say that this is actually changing now due to declining ad revenues. PricewaterhouseCoopers now estimates a 6.2% decline in print advertising and a 1.6% decline in print circulation worldwide for consumer magazines from 2017 to 2022. Now, interestingly, it also predicts a 5.8% increase in digital advertising and a 5.5% growth in digital subscriptions in that same time period. Now, interestingly here, when we look just at B2B, there's a 5.2% forecasted decline in print advertising and a similar drop in print circulation. However, PwC estimates 9% and 13.1% growth in digital advertising and digital subscriptions, respectively, during that same period. It's a much larger number. So, B2B is going to feel this shift in a much more pronounced way, it feels like. This changing business landscape, says the article, has really forced these magazines to start to adopt new business models, a portfolio of businesses. Everything from, you know, advertising to e-commerce to all kinds of affiliate marketing, subscription-based business models, all kinds of portfolios that they're adding into their business to make themselves actually viable. And we've talked about this before in other workshops and certainly in client engagements. One example they bring up is Dennis Publishing, the wonderful car enthusiast publisher media company. And this is a classic example that they speak to where Dennis Publishing went out and bought buyacar.co.uk and carbuyer.co.uk, two websites that not only sell cars, but finance cars as well. So they're in the now car selling and financing business. They are now the UK's leading car purchase and finance platform, representing 21% of all online UK motoring spend. And that's an amazing statistic when you think about it. They also talk about Meredith Corporation, which at 45 million subscribers across their whole portfolio of consumer magazines, has about $500 million in retail sales through its advertisers. That's affiliate marketing, e-commerce, retail brand licensing, etc. And they also talk about Hearst, now $200 million of revenue in merchandise sales through their Hearst products division. And that's an amazing number, selling yoga mats, et cetera, through Hearst, the media company. Now, to me, this is interesting, because if this trend continues into the slower moving, but maybe more pronounced if we believe the PwC numbers, how long is it until we see B2B media companies offering many of the same services that B2B companies offer, things like software, hardware, professional services? As we watch the operational models of publishing change, we have to understand the holistic reasons about why they're doing it. And interestingly, this article tries to explain some of that. When they start looking at why these publishers are shifting so hard, the report talks about this idea that publishers are doing it because they call it the glue that keeps customers engaged. They say that developing this relationship strategy requires an understanding of the customer, of the user, through whole organization transformation, really first-party data there, a customer-focused discipline. Now, this real-time data collection, analysis, and targeting, they say, is the glue that keeps the customer engaged with relevant information. That's building an ecosystem of content that keeps them in there for the transactions and the purchases that they want to make. And that's our business, right? You know, in other words, publishers are now discovering that creating this ecosystem of content that they would normally do and then adding direct sales of products is a way to balance a new business portfolio. We as product and service companies might discover that creating an ecosystem of products and services and adding a level of content can provide the same value and model. Anyway, I think it's a really interesting article. And as I said, I downloaded the research report, which again does require registration. You'll find a link to it in the article itself. So I'm not going to link to it actually in the show notes here, but it's really good. And it talks through the different kinds of paywalls employed by different kinds of magazines through different industries. There's some great case studies, numbers, really good stuff if you're building a business case for gating and or creating some sort of subscription-based model, or even looking at varying kinds of business models for your content marketing. So go take a look. As the intro to the report says, the media industry is on the brink of a new chapter in its history. It's morphing from a transactional print advertising to one being hyper-focused on building lasting, profitable relationships with readers. And I think the same is true for us. I think we're going to morph very quickly here from a transactional sales and marketing business into a hyper-focused set of portfolios that build lasting relationships, wonderful relationships with our audiences. So now, it's time for our interview segment. And we've got a wonderful one for you. It's Randy Wooten. He is the president and GM of Percolate, which is now, of course, a division of Seismic, the content marketing platform. Randy's been a leader and a strategic innovator in the marketing technology industry for two decades. He's got the gray hair just like I do. And you're going to hear some of the wonderful common loves that we have for some of the older marketing out there. Prior to Percolate, Randy served as CEO of the leading predictive marketing platform, Rocket Fuel. That was the ad tech company. And he's also held positions at Microsoft and Salesforce. He's on the board of directors at Guidant Financial and Rallypoint Networks. He's also a graduate of the Harvard Business School, which, of course, I'm a huge fanboy of. And, of course, he's a U.S. Naval graduate as well from the U.S. Naval Academy. So a real underachiever, this Randy guy. He and I talked a lot about what's going on right now today and what it really means to be a publisher in 2020 and how this crisis of COVID and all of the things that we're coming out with here are really affecting our ability to do marketing. I think you're really going to enjoy my interview with Randy. Randy, my friend, how are you doing?
Doing well, Robert. It's been a while. It's great to connect.
It has been a while. You know, we used to get to pass each other in the hall as you were rushing off in content marketing world, and I was rushing off somewhere else in content marketing world, and now we're both locked at home, not going to any events.
Who would have thought going from those types of conferences where we all went to learn some cool stuff, share ideas with peers and meet some new friends, that's possibly never going to happen again in that way. And so now we're in this new world of marketing, and I think it's a really interesting, you know, I was super excited to get a chance to chat with you about what does that mean for content. And I think it's gonna be great to chat a little bit during our conversation.
Yeah, it's going to be fun. It's going to be fun. Well, for those in the audience who don't know who you are, tell us your story. Where did you come from? Where are you now? And I know I happen to know you're sitting in the catbird seat right now, but tell everybody else how you got there.
Well, thanks, Robert. Yeah, so I've been a tech guy for about 20 years, working in online marketing and online advertising, but never the creative guy. I've always been working to help create technology to support marketers in their ambition to create those compelling experiences with prospects and customers. Started in a company called Avenue A, which was became a Quantiv and was bought by Microsoft. Spent about 7 years at Microsoft in the advertising business. Spent some time at Salesforce, and then most recently was a CEO of two companies. One was called Rocket Fuel, which is a public company. It was a programmatic display company, so really focused on trying to understand marketing context, what was happening, the individual in the moment. And then I went to Percolate, which was a content marketing platform, and that was really focused on getting the right message to that person in the right moment. And so I would say, as I look back over the last 20 years, it's all been about trying to realize that vision that Peppers and Rogers had in 1995 with their book, you know, The Future of One-to-One Marketing. Yeah. It seems like you may have read it.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Don Peppers and Martha Rogers, you know, so, I mean, they've written many books, of course, but, you know, I look to that one. The One-to-One Future is truly, like, I think the seminal book in the 90s that had old guys like you and me sort of going, huh, there's going to be a new thing coming. And this whole...
Robert, that was exactly... I read it in 1997. And I was like, this is the future. And then I came out of business school into the internet. And I was like, oh, man, we're gonna create this incredible experience. And at the time, it was really... what we thought was it was really going to be this accretive experience in terms of getting the right message, the right person, the right time, kind of like when Amazon works well.
Right.
It recommends books, and like 1 out of 10, I pick and I buy it without, just because of the recommendation. And I read it, I'm like, yeah, that was a great recommendation. And what I think we've got is the other side of the dark side of the internet that we've all sort of watched play out over the last 20 years, which we may not have thought about, was the tendency to have things siloed and content only being shared within the echo chambers of each other and not promoting a more democratic, free exchange of ideas. So I'm hoping the pendulum will shift back and people will be sharing content in a way to help create a broader appreciation for current reality and options. But yeah, no, that book was seminal for me as well.
Yeah, I mean, it was... You know, well, here we are, right? I mean, here we are 23 years later, you know, sort of, you know, evangelizing it. And I mean, you just talk about things that actually stick in terms of, you know, the ideas that it evangelized. And I had the chance to actually meet Don Peppers a while ago and told him how much his book had meant to me. But speaking of this idea of, you know, where we are 20 years, so, you know, you've got a unique lens. Certainly the path you've taken and the chair in which you sit now, you know, gives you a bit of a unique lens in terms of looking at what publishing looks like today. And, you know, for so many content marketers, they're out there going, you know, they're working for brands. It's the world has changed and all of that. So in 2020, I mean, what does publishing look like in 2020?
Yeah, I think it's a great question, Robert. And I think of it as, I don't think, when brands have been thinking about content marketing, and you and I were chatting about this a little earlier, is like now people are waking up to it. Oh, this content marketing thing, I need to do it. And if you think back, like everyone can argue about when it started. I look back to the American Express Forum, where they were creating content, i.e. a blog, because they called it content marketing so they could separate it from advertising. But you think about what they were doing at that time was providing content into a community in a way to sort of make it so it wasn't them pushing their products. It was them sharing a point of view and facilitating conversations within that construct, MX Forum for small businesses. And it was awesome. But from there, now everybody kind of has different views of what content marketing is. And what has worried me over the last couple of years is that content marketing feels like it's a volume game. Like people, what they want to do is create as much content as possible because they think more is better. And I think that comes from, you get, you know, often young English majors, little artists jumping in and being a product marketer. And they're like, I'm just going to draw, you know, the cost of production is very, very low. Or versus like if you're going to publish a book and have it be published with editors, that's a higher cost. And so the quality bar is higher. Where the bar is low and you just generate and you can put out emails, you can put out blogs, you can put out social posts, it just feels like it's this noise, Cambrian explosion of content. And what I would argue is that, and I'd love to hear your perspective as well, because I think you guys at the Content Marketing Institute did this so well, is if brands think of themselves as publishers, that there's an editorial component to content production, that you have to have a thought leadership agenda that requires you to really think about what you do that's unique, and then you have no more than 3 or 4 specific pillars, and you just go deep in those topics, and you actually go hire people who know how to write. So, you know, what I have been arguing to all the brands that I talk to is go hire those English teachers, or go hire those folks that are editors at magazines today and bring them into your brand so that they can apply the editorial discipline. But also there's a way of looking at the world when you're telling stories, long form stories and narratives, where you're building on these themes, which is different than I'm just generating the next blog post or I'm trying to get my next social post out. And so I think there's a fundamental shift in terms of what does it mean to create a brand narrative that is available.
Yeah, it's funny. It's because in so many ways, I think, you know, marketers over the last 20 years, we've been so focused on, you know, the business has focused marketing so hard on cost and efficiency and becoming efficient pusher of, you know, value through the funnel that we've forgotten in many ways that, you know, one of our major purposes as marketers, going all the way back to Martha and Don Peppers and Martha Rogers and even to our Kotler, you know, which it was always to create value, right?
Yeah.
To create value for the brand and to create value pre-sale. Yep. And that idea of, you know, it's why we've said forever that content marketing isn't new. There's nothing new about it. It's just that now we're actually putting a process, you know, and a strategy around it to make it a formal function in the business to actually deliver this value to a consumer, you know, pre-sale, right? You know, I mean, you know, Andrew Davis, I love the fact that he calls it your pre-customer database, right? You know, it's your, you know, it's not sort of your sales and marketing and leads. It's these are customers that you're delivering value to. Do you think, you know, so what the question we always get, the most common question I always get at workshops and you know, at the conference and all of that is this idea of tracking ROI. I mean, you guys, you know, how have you seen that start to evolve in terms of where content marketing is today?
So I'll give you the answer for Percolate, where I was CEO, and then we sold to Seismic, which is a sales enablement, the largest in the industry company in November. And I'll shift to that because I think it's really interesting to see that play out with sales channel attached. So if you're just using a content marketing platform to generate content, the primary ROI, it's mostly about efficiency and effectiveness. So how do you get a team of people at large companies working against a consistent theme, having content be approved, making sure that people are reusing content versus creating lots of new content? My favorite story on that, Robert, is I was at a large tech company and asked them how much they spent on content production each year. And they said $40 million. And I said, well, how much of it works? And they said, well, we don't have any idea. It's like, best guess. He said 50%. And I said, okay, so that's a $20 million problem. Right. Does anyone care? And he said, well, the way that we budget is it's basically we take last year's budget and we just straight line it, add 3% for this year. So there's never been this focus, or it depends on the company, but it's been so hard to measure. It goes back to Wanamaker. You know, I know 50% of my advertising doesn't work.
Exactly.
I just don't know what it's working. Yeah. I think that applies directly to content as well. And so if we're able to bring more visibility into the content production about how much work is being generated and associate costs with that, then companies are able to say, oh, I am able to produce more content more effectively. And so the assumption then is if you have better campaigns going out with more coordinated content, you have more revenue. So that's the revenue side. What was super interesting to us at Percolate was we think about channels of distribution, and what we were trying to do was coordinate campaign and content across channels, because there is no linear buyer's journey, as we all know. It's buyers are engaging with different assets at different times. And so trying to have a coordinated story across all those touch points is really important. And then to your point, Robert, a lot of people are consuming content before they even engage with the salesperson in a B2B context. And so what now we've been able to do with Seismic is take the content that's being produced in Percolate, put it into a sales enablement tool that then gets distributed via the salespeople, and track what people are doing with it. What part of the content are they only reading the front page of a PowerPoint, or are they engaged in section 1 and 3, but not 2? And we're able to put those analytics and insights back to the salesperson who's able to consume that and then follow up. And in this world in particular, Robert, where we're all distributed, we were chatting a little bit about this earlier, is that every salesperson is now an inside seller. They're not going to go meet their customer. And so their opportunity to understand what prospects are engaging with through their buyer journey and be able to follow up with very specific and detailed content speaks to the buyer's need to get meaningful content when they want it.
It's funny, you know, that we often default because that you would think that the natural tendency there, you know, with that challenge is to have us go, oh, we should, you know, I don't know what to do. So we sort of freeze like a deer in the headlights.
But yeah, right.
And in fact, it's the opposite. We actually start producing more and more and more and more of it, more content, dumping more into the ocean, into the LinkedIns, into Facebook, into,
yeah,
you know, wherever we're dumping in. You talk about this idea of the content bottleneck, and I think that's really related to this.
Yeah, and so this one, it's a, for your listeners, we have an ebook out there called The Content Bottleneck, and you can get it at our website, percolate.com. It was also some thinking we shared at the Content Marketing World a year ago, so it's still very relevant. It came from Gartner, who wrote a report and said that the number one issue facing modern marketers in 2020 is going to be content and the idea of a content bottleneck, meaning that you just can't generate enough content to support the personalization requirements. So going back to Peppers and Rogers, getting right message to the right person at the right time presupposes you can build scalable content and have it be individuated such that you have, you know, unique content going for each person during their buyer journey. It's expensive to do. And so I think what you found is a bunch of people have gone and, you know, they've hired or, you know, outsourced sort of content farms and just produce stuff because I just want to have differentiated. But if you don't, if you haven't thought about that content journey really thoughtfully, like the quality of the content, the quantity of the content, and the coordination of the content production, you're going to end up with a content bottleneck, meaning you've got this incredible demand because you're trying to deliver on personalization or in the B2B segment, ABM, but you don't have enough supply in terms of people jamming it through. And so the question is, what are you doing systematically to solve that problem, the content bottleneck? And everybody has it. And so it and it manifests in different ways for different people. And so that's what, with the ebook, we try to walk through the thinking. And it was actually fascinating because the work was led by one of the co-founders of Percolate, a guy named Noah Breyer, who writes lots of great deep thoughts, and people should follow him no matter what. But for me, what was really interesting is we ended up getting into supply chain theory, which I thought was fascinating in terms of how do you think about content production as a supply chain, and what are you thinking about in terms of information flow and people touching specific content, and what does it mean? And it's absolutely a supply chain problem.
Yeah.
So I think that's what everybody... right now, because people can just generate and distribute, and when most marketing organizations, you have solved by channel. So you have a social team doing social, you have an email team doing email, you have a, you know, programmatic display team doing programmatic display. They're all operating and optimizing for channel specific engagements. You don't have coordination across, and so there's a real risk of just bombarding people with randomness. And so to bring an orchestrated point of view in terms of the set of stories you want to be telling as a publisher along these pillars, the thought leadership pillars, and then having them be created by people who really know how to write and really know how to edit and getting those out, you can create a much more meaningful experience, I think, for the buyers as they go through that journey.
It's a great point, you know, and of course I love, absolutely adore the supply chain metaphor because it's, you know, because it's one that we use as well, right? You know, the idea, we have this idea that we call molecular content, which is around getting a bill of materials for your supply chain, you know, so that you're, you know, you're slowing down the process, right?
Yep.
You know, when we start talking about supplying content to the rest of the organization and we start talking about the, you know, the idea of, yeah, you're going to shift this idea of always responding to the on-demand vending machine of content idea, yeah, and instead get into a supply chain mode where you're, yeah, actually proactively putting together things that may not be needed for 6 weeks, 8 weeks, 12 weeks, but you're going to do it together because now you don't have to redo it. You don't have to, you know, you don't have to you can repackage it and reuse it and do all of those things. And then, you know, the immediate pushback on that, of course, is people go, oh, wait a minute. You mean you're going to slow down the process of, and I'm like, yes, we actually are going to slow down the process, but wait for it. Because at the end, when people are going, hey, I want to reuse something, or I want to repackage something, or I want to redo something, now you're not recreating the wheel. You're just going right into the system, you know, whatever software tech package you have and saying, we've got it ready to go. We've got That's it ready right. to rock and roll. And, you know, you've built all of the variations of it a priori. So it works so much better. So it speeds up just if you slow down.
And that's one of those old adages. I think you're spot on, Robert. Two quick thoughts. One is I think we've not done ourselves a good service with the internet, which means that we've become hyper, focused on measurability. So to your earlier point, like everything had to be around conversions and it was all driven bottom of the funnel. And how do I optimize an email campaign versus a social campaign? That's number one. Number two is, I think that social, the pace and pattern of social has put this intense demand on marketers to just generate. Like I don't tweet. I just can't keep up with it, right? But there are people who like all day long are tweeting in their 140 characters.
And one really in particular.
Yeah, right. And, yeah, indeed. And we see how that works. But I think that what we have found, to your point, is when people are trying to be strategic in the stories they're telling and make the time to think about the campaign strategy and their thought leadership agenda, that's the primary level of what you want to be doing as a CMO with your leaders in terms of narrative. And it's super hard. Like, how are you unique? Why couldn't someone just take your logo and put it on someone else's logo? Like for me as a MarTech guy, there are 10,000 vendors out there that are all in and around this space. And so our ability to really tell a compelling narrative was one of the ways I think the founders of Percolate broke through. Is they had a guy, Noah, who was just an incredible writer. He was a marketer and he just had a point of view and he just wrote and people wanted him to speak. And so we had the thought leader. And I think that being able to then take that thought leadership and translate it into campaign strategies and briefs helps to your point, ensure that we're building content once, reusing it lots. And what I tell people, like, look, it doesn't warrant creating a brief, it doesn't warrant building. Like, if you're not going to spend the time and tell me exactly who you're trying to reach, what's the message you're trying to land, and how it connects with our overall narrative, we're not going to build it. And so I think that also slows things down, but it forces that upstream thinking around what am I really trying to do here versus, oh my God, I got to respond to the latest tweet and just get something out. It's you've got these themes that support a broader narrative in the marketplace.
It's almost as if we were strategic.
Yeah, well, you hope. I mean, and everybody wants to do that, Robert. Yeah, I mean, I think,
right, of course.
But they end up doing all this other stuff. It's like they're consumed with the urgent, hopefully it's important. Sometimes it's the not important, but urgent. And that's, we all want to create ways of moving away from that and going to the important, not urgent. And I think as you move in your career, that's exactly what you hope to be doing, is making strategic bets and helping to inform how brands and companies position themselves in the marketplace.
I could geek out about this all day with you, my friend. In the spirit of time, I want to make sure, where can people connect with you? What's coming up for you next? And where should people go to find out more about what your thinking is and what you guys are up to?
Yeah, so I think, the companies have come together. We still have two websites. So if people are interested really in activating their B2B sales channel, that's start at seismic.com. If they're interested in this broader conversation around content marketing, so if you're head of marketing, head of communications, start at percolate.com. That's also where you'll find the blogs and the ability to download the eBooks. We have three in the series that all sort of revolve around these issues. I'm always happy to take an email and talk to someone. I'm R Wootton, Wootton, at seismic.com. I would just ask that your listeners say that Robert sent me, because I get a bunch of unsolicited emails every single day, like you do.
You're the only one, my friend. You're the only one who's
crushing. But if someone says, "Hey, I heard you on the podcast or on the Weekly Wrap, or I heard you, I want to talk about content marketing world," I'll certainly respond and create time to chat. And strategize about your content strategy or operations or technology. It's something I've been passionate about for 20 years and still excited about doing it another 20.
Fantastic. Thank you so much for being on the show today, Randy. I so appreciate it. Thank you for coming on.
My pleasure. Hope to see you in person again sometime.
Right on.
Cheers.
That Well, that brings us to our last segment, which is one post on CMI's site that I'd love for you to take a look at, a first look at, a second or a third look at. And quite honestly, it's a post from earlier this week because it's important and we want to recognize that importance. We took a break from Weekly Wrap last week, as I said, because we were taking that pause, time to listen. And as I said in my letter last week and at the top of the show, nothing I say today is going to teach me. So today I listen, and we did spend some good time listening. But this week, our fearless leader, Stephanie Stahl, she took the time to write and to speak. And she wrote how really this idea of content can really truly, if we're not careful, perpetuate racism and inequity. It's time for us to do better, she said, and I think I full-heartedly and full-throatedly agree. And in this piece, Steph acknowledges the systemic racism that has brought all of us to this historic moment. And it's a fantastic piece, as you might guess, and one that comes both from the head and the heart. And as Stephanie says, it's not time to start talking about it. It's time to start doing it. It's time to start creating actions from our words. And we'll certainly be working on doing much better in everything we do from an inclusivity perspective. So go check out the post. I think you'll get a lot out of it. I certainly did. And well, that's a wrap of episode number 73. I hope you're all well, truly. I believe that you need to be safe in this time. And I hope you're all taking care of each other, giving each other hugs, and really working with one another. Taking a pause can really be helpful. And one thing that I'm certainly grateful for is that you've decided to take a pause with this show on occasion. And I hope you're liking it. I really do hope that you enjoy the show that we're having a lot of fun putting together for you, and especially episode 2 of our video version of this particular show. And if there's anything you want to see, any guests you want to see, any topics you want us to cover, hashtag us up, won't you? Social media at hashtag The Weekly Wrap. And if you're not liking the show, like you didn't love it, you didn't hate it, you just sort of, whatever, I don't really understand what this guy is doing, you can always unsubscribe. You can always not watch the show. In the immortal words of Willie Nelson,
maybe I didn't love you quite as often as I could have. Maybe I didn't treat you quite as good as I should have. If I made you feel
for now, second. For now, let's think about the art of conversation and the power of the pause. We marketers are often tempted by technology to shorten the time, to continuously shorten the time between the time when our customers speak and when we speak. Software lets someone immediately call or email a prospect after they've downloaded that white paper. But should we? AI chatbots now allow companies to instantaneously respond to any customer query. But should they? Research actually shows that a delay can provide a more satisfying experience. Should you wait until you have every answer before responding to that question on social media? Or should you respond immediately, letting them know of your intention to have a more valuable response for them in time? Or is social media even a channel you need to be on, full stop? There is power in both taking a pause and not taking one. In marketing, we often talk about delivering the right message to the right customer at the right time. But that assumes that we're deciding what right is. It's our time. As we start working on more artful, real-time conversations with our customers, remember there may be just as much value in delivering the right pause to the right customer, but in their time. It's your story, folks. Tell it well. See you next week on The Weekly Wrap.